The Right Choice Initiative Program at Savannah State University, a Title III funded program, in collaboration with the National Freedom Day Association, presents to you National Freedom Day. Thank you for joining us this evening.
National Freedom Day is very near and dear to my heart. All my life growing up, I heard this phrase, tell them we are rising. And so I always knew of the efforts that Richard Wright Sr. did here at Savannah State. But when he left and took the family to Philadelphia, one of the main focuses he had was the creation of National Freedom Day. National Freedom Day essentially marks the date that the 13th Amendment was signed into law. We had the Emancipation Proclamation, but until it was a law, we really were not free. Richard Wright had the foresight to petition President Truman at the time and get it signed and make it a national holiday. So all of my years, on February 1st, the family and others in Philadelphia have celebrated this important date.
I'm Kimberly Ballard Washington, president of Savannah State University, and I'm very happy to welcome you as we celebrate National Freedom Day. National Freedom Day commemorates the abolishment of slavery, the 13th Amendment, which was signed on January 31st, 1865. Many years later, in 1948, President Truman, on the advice and counsel of our first president, Richard R. Wright, signed this day into law, National Freedom Day. We are grateful for those actions, and we celebrate the life, the legacy, as we continue.
My HBCU experience. Hello, beautiful people. My name is Aaron Walker, and I go to the Savannah State University. Being at HBCU makes me feel like I can achieve almost anything. It just brings the best out of me. Why choose an HBCU, you may ask? Besides homecoming, we have the best fried chicken Wednesdays you can ever imagine. Come on, you aren't gonna turn down no chicken. But with all seriousness, HBCUs are more affordable, you are surrounded with diversity, the atmosphere is something that you can't make up, and last but not least, you will feel like you are at home. At an HBCU, you are never alone. We are a family. There are always people willing to guide, help, and make sure that you are on the right track. When I arrived on campus as a freshman, I was very nervous, and I didn't know what to expect. When I fully got settled in my dorm, I just couldn't believe that I'm on my own. I'm a very shy kid when it comes to meeting new people. I had luckily found a group of friends that I still have to this day. Being around them helps me be able to step out of my comfort zone and make new connections. My first time attending class was very different than an average high school class. The professors are very open and are willing to help you in every way. Before I got here, I've heard that the professors were very rude and strict. When I arrived, it was a total opposite. COVID played a huge part of my freshman experience. It was like we couldn't enjoy the full HBCU experience. We didn't have no in-person classes, nor any in-person activities. Even homecoming was virtual. While I'm here at Savannah State University, I would like to get the full HBCU experience since I wasn't able to do so because of COVID. I am super excited for my future here at this HBCU, and I can't wait to accomplish as many goals as I can. I hope you all enjoy learning about my HBCU experience. Once again, my name is Aaron Walker. I am a sophomore who majors in mass communications here at the Savannah State University. Thanks for watching.
Hi, I'm Jordan Sampson, a sophomore student at Savannah State University, majoring in Computer Information and Logistics Systems. This is my entry video for Savannah State's The Right Choice Initiative's National Freedom Day video contest, where the theme this year is The HBCU Experience, A Tale of Liberation. I chose to attend an HBCU for the combination of culture and education. When I arrived at SSU, I knew that I was going to an HBCU with a great business program and one in the city of Savannah, Georgia, which I knew I loved. But what made me fall in love with SSU is the people and its history. Looking more into National Freedom Day, I discovered that it was started by Major Richard R. Wright Sr., who was also the first president of Savannah State University under its original name of Georgia State Industrial College for Colored Youths in 1890. The journey of Richard R. Wright from enslavement to president of Georgia's first public HBCU is a story of liberation that has empowered generations to follow in his footsteps. Savannah State University has two mottos that we go by. Tell them we are rising and we can get anywhere from here. Carrying the legacy of those sayings is an everyday action for each and every student and alumni of Savannah State. Whether it is in class or being involved with organizations, we continue to go anywhere from our firm foundation of Savannah State University. Personally, being at an HBCU, specifically Savannah State, has been an amazing experience for me because representation matters. During homecoming week this year, there was a panel discussion of SSU alumni who work at large, prominent tech companies. And being able to sit in and listen on that panel discussion of alumni that are pouring back into their university to be able to educate the next generation was really amazing to see and to be a part of, because that's truly the experience of seeing people get anywhere from here. Because I've seen some people from Savannah State participate in the Olympics to just really being in places that are huge, actors, actresses, business people. It's amazing to see the legacy being carried on. And it's just really inspiring to be at a university that has a continued legacy of that for not just a couple years, but since its founding. And I hope to continue that legacy of SSU to tell everyone that we're rising and that we will continue to get anywhere from here. And that's on 1890 right there.
Since the third grade, I knew that it was my destiny and goal to attend a HBCU.
I would go for my ancestors that weren't allowed to read and write, and be an added name to the Black excellence that was birthed out of these universities like Richard R. Wright. I knew I wanted to go for those who never had the opportunity to. Trayvon Martin, Michael Brown, Ayanna Jones, Tamir Rice, just a small few who were like me but never got to fully live their life.
With my face turned to the sun.
I wanted to go somewhere where it would feel like family and not another statistic. Not another large classroom with no real interaction in it. Not a place where I would be around people who didn't think I was capable of having wit, but those who knew I could and would be successful. A place that was full of tradition, Saturday football games with a marching band and dance line that intensified the rivalry and hyped the crowd with energy and movement. Homecoming that brought together a family of all ages and contributed good laughs, good seasoned food, and anthems that will always get every person wired and singing in unison. Sororities and fraternities that build everlasting sisterhoods and brotherhoods and exemplify the definition of culture. A setting where I could be comfortable and proud of the skin I'm in and bask at the different variations of melanin, texture of hair, and slang within my race, and even meet others from different nationalities and accept them with respect and grace. So when people ask, "Was the HBCU your first choice?" I proudly say yes, because in third grade, I knew, which eventually led to choosing SSU, and now I'm forever screaming, "Go Big Blue!" Hey, hey!
Hi, my name is Lyric Escal, and I love my HBCU experience. I chose to go to an HBCU because I wanted to be in a space that centered Blackness at its core. Going to an HBCU has been one of the most amazing experiences of my life. I love being able to meet other Black people my age that all have common interests, different interests, because Blackness truly is just, you know, it's not a monolith. It's truly just a culmination of so many interests and so many things. And the culture there is just so broad and creative. It just makes a wonderful learning experience because you're always going to meet someone new who challenges your ideas in new and different ways. And it's just a really good experience. And even though stuff has been virtual now, it's still a really good experience, even on Zoom, because, you know, we're all going through very similar things together. There's just an underlying understanding of Blackness that where the precedent doesn't need to be set. It's already there once you walk through the door. Everyone just kind of, you know, there's just certain things that you just already get and understand that I don't think not going to HBCU would have provided that for me. So I absolutely 100% encourage anyone who is thinking about it to consider and go to an HBCU because you will not regret it. It is one of the best experiences I have had in my life.
My name is Akbar the Great from Columbus, Ohio, and I'm in love with the HBCU experience. My HBCU experience impacted my life trajectory in so many different ways, just from landing so many different internships, having the opportunity to do so many different internships, from the career fairs that they bring in to, you know, connecting and networking with people from different cities, different major cities in America, from Chicago to D.C. to Sacramento, you know what I'm saying? People come from everywhere to go to HBCUs, and so you really get to a melting pot of all these different Black cultures and different Black cities. And it's just a beautiful thing, man. And so it kind of just gave me it just exposed me to a lot of different things. And with exposure comes a new perspective, you know, and that's why, you know, it's important to be exposed to things, especially as a young person, just because you don't want to have a closed off perspective going into adulthood. And so I felt like my HBCU gave me that in so many different ways, and I would never be able to repay it, you know what I'm saying? But it's just love. What made me decide to attend the HBCU is really just the legacy and the culture of HBCUs in America. Just from the products that they've put out, Martin Luther King to Thurgood Marshall, countless others. And I just really wanted to be a part of that. I wanted to be a part of that legacy. And also just the love that I have for Black people, for my culture. You know what I'm saying? It's unmatched, man. So HBCU, the environment, once you step foot on campus, is really just an unmatched environment, man, that you're not going to find anywhere else unless you go to a different HBCU elsewhere. So that's what really rounded my decision. There are plenty of hurdles that I had to overcome and plenty of hurdles that I experienced just being involved with an HBCU. a lot of people like to put out this stigma or the misinformation that if you go to an HBCU opposed to going to a PWI, it'll be harder for you to get a job in corporate America or harder for you to find a job in the career field that you want to pursue. When in reality, I just found that to be the opposite of the truth, man. I found it so much easier coming from my HBCU to do internships in corporate America, working for Skanska, doing internships for Vantive, City Hall in Columbus, Ohio, working with a lot of different engineers. So, you know, I feel like the only way to overcome the subconscious hurdles that they like to place on us as we're coming up is just by, you know, exhibiting and exuding Black excellence.
My name is Kiyomi Rollins, and I absolutely love my HBCU experience. Attending North Carolina Central University was one of the best decisions of my life. It impacted me in a way that I was able to really be in a space that was rooted in Blackness, tradition, and just all around the most Blackest experience I've ever had. It impacted me that I'm now the CEO of three successful social impact brands that are actually rooted in our culture, in our traditions, and in everything that just celebrates our culture that is for us and by us. Attending an HBCU was the place that I knew that I needed to be, deserved to be, and I was celebrated. I'd encourage anyone that is looking at this video and looking at the rest of these collections of videos, the space that you need to be in is at an HBCU. It is the Blackest thing ever and the best experience in your life.
My name is Matthew Wesley Williams, and I love the HBCU experience. I decided to attend an HBCU first as an undergraduate at Florida A&M University, then as a master's student at the Interdenominational Theological Center. Because I entered college and then graduate theological education, knowing that the calling on my life was to serve and better the condition of our people. I had friends and counselors who would say HBCUs don't prepare you for the real world, as if to say the only reality worth preparing for is one in which we are undervalued, under-resourced, and marginalized in comparison to others. But HBCUs correct that narrative and give us the capability and confidence to own every space we occupy, knowing that we belong there and we are second to none. In the words of John Sylvanus Wilson, former president of Morehouse College, other institutions often hold a question mark over our heads, which causes us to question our ability and whether we belong there. HBCUs hold a crown over students' heads, inspiring us to rise to the full stature that God and our ancestors intended for us. I would absolutely recommend an HBCU to any rising student seeking to make an impact in the world. I now serve as the 11th president of my graduate alma mater, the Interdenominational Theological Center, a historically Black graduate theological school in the heart of the Atlanta University Center. My HBCU experience changed my life. Now I bear the responsibility to help carry forward that legacy for the next generation.
Good evening, and welcome to our second virtual National Freedom Day commemoration. We're so grateful to be here at Savannah State University, where our founding president, after he left here of 30 years of service, traveled to Philadelphia and was the architect of the idea of celebrating the emancipation of slavery. In 1948, he petitioned then President Truman, and President Truman marked it as a national holiday. So for over 70 years, this has been celebrated in Philadelphia. When I arrived here at Savannah State University, the first thing I wanted to do was make sure that we continued that legacy of the founder with the celebration of National Freedom Day. Due to COVID-19 and the pandemic, we've pivoted. And tonight we will share a virtual celebration of National Freedom Day. I'm joined here tonight by some stellar scholars here at Savannah State University. And I wanna make sure I give special thanks and shout out to the people that have worked behind the scenes to make this wonderful event take place. This could not have happened, especially without Mr. Kareem McMichael, who has produced and edited this entire celebration, and without the support of our President Kimberly Ballard Washington, none of this would be possible. It's so exciting that tonight we're joined by a recent graduate. Mr. Sean Edwards is here serving as our moderator tonight, and I will now put it in his hands. Thank you and enjoy.
Good evening and welcome. My name is Sean Wesley Edwards, and I am here today serving as your moderator for the 2022 National Freedom Day celebration. Today, I am here with a number of wonderful scholars from the University of Savannah State, and I will allow them now to introduce themselves to you. Go ahead.
My name is Carissa Moore, and I'm from Waldorf, Maryland.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Justin Ellington, and I am from Savannah, Georgia.
Hello, my name is Tiffany Wright, and I'm from Jacksonville, Florida.
Greetings, my name is Alexander Richardson, and I'm from Riverdale, Georgia.
Good evening, my name is Dr. Carolyn Jordan, and I hail from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
My name is Sean Edwards, and I'm from Cleveland, Ohio.
Good evening, I'm Ian Sanville, and I hail from Miami, Florida.
Hey everybody, my name is Kayma Duhart, and my hometown is Maryville.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Nicole Dorsey, and I hail from the beautiful island of Nassau, Bahamas.
Good evening. My name is Ramsey Ali Basir, and I came to Savannah State from Copperleaf, Hawaii.
As you can see, these wonderful students, including myself, hail from places all over the United States and then some. Today, we're about to go ahead and get into a conversation in which we'll share some of our experiences and see how many of those overlap despite our regional differences. All right, so the first question that I want to ask you all is, what inspired you to come from your hometowns to the city of Savannah to attend this HBCU?
My reason to come to an HBCU was very special. Growing up in Jacksonville, there wasn't a heavy emphasis in my family. It was just get your education. And then in spring 2007, I crossed into Delta Land and became a Delta. And meeting my sorors and hearing about their HBCU experience is really what got me first looking at how different it is from the PWI experience. Because I got a degree from a PWI in Jacksonville, Florida. And so when I knew I wanted to go back to school for my new passion in life, I knew I wanted to be at HBCU. I chose Savannah State University because doing research about my ancestors, I learned that they hailed from this region, and I thought it would be just that much more special to come to the land that my ancestors were in, and it just has been such a rewarding experience. And everything that everyone said, it has been that and some. And choosing to come to a school that specifically was created for me as a Black woman, as a Black scholar, versus just fitting into a PWI, has truly made all the difference.
Phenomenal. And with that being said, there are so many different reasons and things that could have driven us in this direction to where we end up, where we are now, right? And in front of one another, sharing this stage to share those experiences. And in fact, even for myself, I was actually supposed to go to Georgia Tech initially. That was the college that my parents wanted me to go to. And I ended up not going simply because I didn't have the money at the time to pay for the application fee. So believe it or not, I ended up at Savannah State because they had a free application, filled it out, went to Savannah State, completely ignorant to what the HBCU experience had in store for me. And as I came here as a fledgling student, I had the opportunity to not only see what was built with the purpose of educating our people, but have another purpose instilled inside of me. Right? Because I didn't, when you're in high school and you're younger and you're thinking about what you want to do, you're just thinking about your future, thinking about your future, thinking about your career, thinking about what you want your life to be like. But there's really no true purpose yet infused into whatever that dream or that goal is. And once you come here and you meet these individuals, you hear their stories, you go through the struggles and the hardships that make up any experience, but the ones very specific and unique to the HBCU experience, that is when you understand where it plays a part in your overall trajectory. That's when you understand the point of having a purpose infused into your passion, right?
I would say for myself, I appreciate your story because you mentioned that you wanted to go to an HBCU. But for myself, after high school, I had no idea what I was going to do, where I wanted to be, and et cetera, et cetera. But my aunt, who is a graduate of Savannah State, said, why don't you just try it? I was like going to the National Guard, something that I really didn't want to do. But she said, just try it. And I got here, and my initial thought was, I'm probably not going to like it. I'm going to do 2 years, and I'm going to transfer and just be done. But as soon as I got here, I think it's something about Savannah State specifically, but it just engulfs you in the history and the culture and the legacy and the family orientation and just everything about Savannah State. It literally became a part of me. And that first semester, I felt home. I felt like I was wanted here. Somebody wanted me here, and I'm so happy that I chose this place because not only was my aunt a brother, but everybody here who are alums and even not alums, they definitely wanted to see my trajectory be as beautiful as it can for me. And I don't think that I would have been able to get that same experience at any other place. So I appreciate your experience because it's different from mine, but we still ended up here.
Let's go ahead and keep it flowing. So with all of the different experiences that you've heard thus far from myself and my wonderful colleagues here, right, even though we're not in college anymore, some of us, I'll drop the next question. What are some of the skills that you feel like needed to be added to your arsenal and that only took place because of the experiences that you had at your HBCU?
I would say me and my HBCU at Savannah State University, one, I'm so glad I chose Savannah State. I think Savannah State really helped me become out of my comfort zone to be a leader and speak out in front of people. I think behind the scenes, you know, it's a lot of people say, oh yeah, you know, you look great doing this, you should be running this organization, whatever the case may be. But not everybody has taken the time and effort to really push you behind the scenes and teach you how to work and be the leadership and scholar that you need to be prepared for in the real world. And I feel like I would be not only able to prepare to be a leader, but someone that my peers can rely on to help guide them the way that someone else is able to help guide me.
I love it.
Yeah, I really love that. Leadership. And I can hear it in your voice, the way that you articulated the things that you just articulated with such fluence, fluentness. Is a testament to the skill sets that you have honed as a result of being exposed to the people that you've been exposed to and the opportunities that you have had. And it's great that your fellow students recognize that, as do I. I'll have to put you on the spot here just because you got the shaft, the sash. It draws a little bit of attention to you, and I would love to hear about how leadership has been a skill that has impacted your ability to contribute to not only your HBCU, but in areas outside of them.
Thank you for that. Truly say that attending Savannah State University has been one of the best decisions I've ever made. Upon coming here, I didn't know that I wanted to attend a HBCU, but from the first day I took a tour here, I knew that this was my home. Coming to Savannah State, I also knew I wanted to join leadership to make a change in the Chatham County community. So joining this organization, Student Government Association, and accepting the title as Mr. Sophomore has been great. Like, this has been an awesome experience. It gave me the opportunity to inclusive lead. It gave me the opportunity to be a role model in the community and in the school. So I definitely say this was a great opportunity, and I would love to do it all over again if I could.
I can definitely add on to that with you saying being a part of SGA really kind of helped you with your leadership because as for me, I was only a junior when I got into SGA, and I was SGA vice president. So that leadership kind of really definitely helped me do that because in high school I was in leadership, but it was a different level, you know, being in, you know, a different, I would say diverse community is kind of like, you have to lead according to where you're at. I was like in placement and where, you know, your position is, but coming to college, my sophomore becoming a soul, you know what I'm saying? Being the only male soul, having that type of leadership is very unique at an HBCU because you get to lead in a different aspect and lead your people either, or definitely just lead them into the right direction, you know, and always have help behind your back, always.
I would say amongst student leadership, something I guess a little bit different, a skill that I gained from being here is, if you want to call it a skill, a sense of self. I definitely did not have that growing up where I grew up. Metter is a very small country town. But being here and being amongst my peers, being amongst people who look like me and being a part of a legacy that is so rich, and then majoring in Africana studies also definitely allowed me to gain a sense of who I am and where I come from and get a better gauge of where I'm going. So I definitely owe that to Savannah State and owe it to an HBCU.
It was a beautiful sentiment that you all just shared, right? That leadership has impacted your trajectory, your confidence, who you are. It's been added to your essence as a person. It's helped you become more well-rounded. Not only that, it's helped you be able to become more relatable as far as the story of success, right? Because you come from where everybody else comes from that can relate to your beginning, right? And then now you're showing them that, hey, no matter what you are going through, I was there before, and now I'm showing you what the path looks like to get out of that, to break out of that. People say they're not confident at speaking in front of people. Public speaking is something that they need to work on. Then what happens? Now you, somebody who may have struggled with speaking in front of people confidently, is out here leading your class, leading people in the community, and also congregating with other leaders that have more experience than you, and you're being able to be the bridge that brings that back to those people, right? So I think that's beautiful. And with that being said, Ramsey, I'm gonna have to pick on you a little bit. As a person that holds a current leadership role as the president of Way of Real Discovery Incorporated, special place in my heart. I wanna hear what you have to say about your experience and leadership and how that has enhanced you.
Yeah, I can definitely speak, a whole lot to that point, because I think everyone touched on something I would have said. I mean, we all have a similar experience, even though very various, in the essence of it. But I didn't quite know I was going to be here. I came to Atlanta expecting to go to Georgia State from Hawaii because I was majoring in film, and I was really more concerned with being a scholar than just an entrepreneur or the other things that I could call myself today. But one of the things that did draw me to Savannah State was the presence of word, actually just on social media, which is something, my leadership I'm trying to emphasize. It's just a whole lot of who I am and who Savannah as a city and a school, itself has made me is because of the examples that were set for me. Sean himself is actually to this day, I met him 2-3 years ago, he's one of my most, stark and strong examples that I want to, follow. People who I want to be, attributes that I want to, portray for the people that I do lead and everyone that, has ever known me. It's just, it's become a really, honorable piece of who I am, the city itself, and my choice to be here. I was also ignorant to just what going to an HBCU does have to offer to the self. I completely underestimated what it could give me. And one point that I feel like everyone might agree with but didn't quite say, it's hard to explain. Mm-hmm. The feeling and the experience and the things that you gain from being here, it's hard to explain. It's something you have to experience for yourself. Mm-hmm. And like you said, it's not like anything else. That's really all I can say. It's just probably like you have to say.
To add to that point that it's hard to explain, when I feel for myself, I would say, when some students of a PWI, this isn't picking, like they'll say HBCU or something like that, I think for us, there's a sense of like, you don't understand completely because you may not be here. And it is hard to explain that there is a very, 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 not arrogant, but pride when you attend HBCU. And like you said, it's hard to explain, but it's something that's there. And if you're not here, you may not be able to get it, But that's at the point.
And that's all HBCUs, but particularly this HBCU. I'm pretty much on the same page. I talked to several different people about how their experience was. And in my opinion, I'm having the best one. I believe that's for everyone. Like, everyone has their own experiences. However, you're unable to talk about my HBCU if you did not attend my HBCU.
Speaking this time as a non-traditional student about that pride thing, I was going to say that it's so interesting when you're in a space where you're allowed to be all of your facets of self, mm-hmm. and be unapologetic about it. Being at Savannah State, being at HBCU, even at my older age, has taught me to be so unapologetic about how I create, how I share, how I represent myself in the world, and to not have to hide my Blackness. Being here has allowed me to just more own who I am, and even people back home, when they see me now and see how I move and see how I speak and the things that I communicate, they say, Savannah has done something to you. You're glowing. Like, it, you're blossoming, you're blooming, like they can feel it, and I can't even put it into words, but I'm so thankful to be in an environment where I can talk about my culture, I can talk about, because I'm a visual performing arts major, and I make films, and I do choreography, I'm a creative all around, and so it has even affected my pride in my work and the type of work that I create. I don't try to create work that's for everybody. I create it for me and my people, and whoever else relates to it, that's fine. But I never would have had the boldness to do that if it were not here. So Savannah State, if that can be called a skill, has allowed me to develop pride.
Mm-hmm. One thing I would say is I remember, both, like I said, both my parents attended the HBCU. So I remember when I was initially talking to my mom about exactly which HBCU I would attend, because it wasn't an option. I was going to attend PWI or HBCU. It was going to be HBCU. The main thing was, you know, she told me, she's like, Carissa, you have your whole life to be a minority. Why would you? This is the one time in your life you don't have to be a minority. You don't have to worry about, you know, self-coding, this and the third. You can just be yourself and be around people who can be themselves too and really figure out who people are. And that's what really made Savannah so special to me. I know, even learning the history about it, like AJ said, you know, every HBCU is great, but this HBCU, like with Richard R. Wright, you know, that whole story of him telling, you know, tell them we are rising, and really seeing that a lot of people don't understand the connection, you know, with the second president of FAMU coming from Savannah State and W.E.B. Du Bois and just all these great people who were influenced by Richard R. Wright and somehow, some way were incorporated into Savannah State's history. A lot of people don't know that, and that's me personally why I take pride, you know, doing the whole Founders Day that we did last semester, really learning my HBCU history and how that led it to me. And then even from my own personal experience, I know on my mom's side, great, 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 great grandmother, last person in slavery, 10 children. By the time slavery was ended in 1865, she only knew where 4 of them were. So I know for that whole situation of being, you know, a young Black girl in this country, I wasn't supposed to be here. So the fact that I'm here, I am here and I am able to thrive, it just makes this experience more worthwhile.
Yeah, I just wanted to highlight something. As I'm hearing all of these articulate, wonderful scholars, I wonder if you would speak to opportunities for scholarship that you have received as a result of being here and how that may have impacted or changed your journey in any way.
So that was super special to me. Again, talking about how my first degree I got was at a PWI, and I graduated high school as a valedictorian, 4.23 GPA. But I did not get a full ride to that school. Even with my high school, there was kind of like some politics, I feel, that guidance didn't really set me up how I should have been set up. And so coming to Savannah State and already having, you know, credits and all these things that maybe I don't always qualify for government aid because I already have all these credits from another degree, how the faculty, administrative staff has worked. And so I'm going to get emotional.
Get emotional.
How they have made sure that I could get this degree. I've never seen that level of care ever. And these past few semesters, now that I've capped out in credits, they have done everything they could to make sure I can still come here and get all the scholarships and everything that I can. They're like, we want to make sure you graduate and go on to do great things. And so truly Savannah State cares about their students and making sure that we can get this degree, and then if they see that you care, you're making good grades. Like I got a 4.0 last semester, got a 4.0 the semester before that, and they see that, and instead of being like shrug, oh well, they're like trying to figure that thing out, and they have. And ever since I have reached that cap of credits, they have made sure every semester I didn't have to worry about a thing. And so that was just such a blessing for me, because I feel like it came full circle, because I feel like the care I should have gotten that first time around and that I didn't, it's like I'm getting it now. So it just meant a
lot. Well, for me, you know, with scholarships and everything, you know, that's real near, true, dear to my heart. You know, coming from high school, I kind of was like on the line of not knowing where I wanted to go or what to do.
I know I had to go get an education in college. That's what my parents always instilled in me, but I didn't know anything outside of HBCUs or just college in general. So I was planning on probably going full-fledged without Austin State. You know, all they was throwing at me was loans. You know, with me being all active in the community, with community service just being a stellar student I was back in high school, you know, the director of admissions just came down to Jenkins High School right up the street and called me up in the counselor's office. And mind you, I was just sitting right there in the filling out applications for colleges. You know, I just saw it like, you know, a gift from God, you know, looking back on it now. He was like, I'm looking for this student. My counselor came out. Well, he just sitting right here. He was like, look, I nominate you for this full ride scholarship, a board of business scholarship, and I just need you to fill this out, just, you know, complete the application, and you got a full ride to come to Savannah State. And, you know, for me, I just felt like, you know, taking away all the loans and, you know, all that financial debt for my family, you know, putting us in that, you know, hole and everything. I just, you know, was just so thankful for the opportunity of just getting a full ride just to Savannah State. And ever since I came to this institution, you know, it's just been nothing but great to me and, you know, my family.
So much how everyone else was. I kind of was, I had the GPA, you know, I thought I did it learning about scholarships for real, or student loans, how to pay for college till my senior year. And I wish someone could have told me better ways to do it. One thing, I didn't know you had to pay for applications. I thought you could just apply. I didn't know you had to pay, even if you didn't want to go to the school. Second thing was, which is another thing I learned, and I remember I waited till around like January, February of 2021 to start my scholarship process, and my mom, she kept getting on me, and she made me realize, you know, the scholarship process to get you a full ride starts way before you even step foot on your campus. It starts with your mindset. It starts with, do you even know what it means to pay $100,000 for school? Do you know what that means? That $100,000 by the time you leave might be $200,000 with debts and everything and loans on top of the interest that you paid it off. And then I worked my butt off to make sure I got my high school scholarships. And then, you know, they saw how I did well in high school. I was accepted into the honors program, which led me to get the presidential waiver. And the presidential waiver luckily took over my out-of-state tuition to be in-state tuition. So instead of paying $14,000 a semester, I was only paying $7,000. All my other scholarships took care of the rest of it. And the real payoff was not even me getting my education, but me seeing my mom, you know, seeing someone that raised me for 18 years. And it's like, we had a conversation. She's like, you know, you doing this doesn't really hurt you. It hurts me. Because at the end of the day, you know, if I didn't get any scholarships, she was going to be breaking her back to make sure, on top of her own student loans, to make sure I was okay and I was still able to get my education. So I definitely understand that from a personal perspective.
I decided to attend an HBCU, Savannah State University, because my sisters had influenced me. So my family was, of course, for me going there, and while I initially did not want to go, I followed their instruction and their lead, and I'm so glad that I did. There were some hurdles that I experienced while attending there. The main hurdles were external, in that I was found myself competing against other classmates that were with me in high school and other individuals that were going to other institutions. And there are some who made me feel, or wanted to make me feel, as if I was getting a substandard education because I was attending an HBCU. And to overcome those hurdles, I had to apply myself. I had to make sure that I studied and make sure that I was able to compete with them in various aspects of education. The qualities that I developed while at an HBCU primarily were honesty and integrity. At Savannah State University, the instructors, almost all of them, encouraged each and every one of us who were students to make sure that we were applying ourselves, that our work was our work, that we did not plagiarize, and that we were going to be held accountable for that work which we turned in. The other quality and that I developed was self-confidence. Self-confidence. I was made to feel as if I was just as good as any other student that was going to any other institution, and that I could make it going to an HBCU. Why? Because there were so many more who had already made it. I would recommend attending an HBCU to everybody, no matter what race, what creed, what color, because of the affection and because of the intensity that the HBCU afforded me and have afforded other individuals, I believe that anyone who chooses to go will also be just that successful. It impacted me, it impacted my trajectory. Attending the HBCU, it impacted my trajectory in that I was able to become a pastor at this point of a major inner city church, and I don't believe I would have been as prepared as I am now with my calling and with my implementation of helping other individuals. Also, I'm a veteran teacher. Just a few years after graduating from Savannah State University, I entered into the local school system, and I've been teaching ever since. And I'm very proud of being able to do that. In enabling myself, the HBCU enabled me to help individuals that are students, to help them find themselves and to help themselves and to give them a reason to continue on in hopes that they will also attend an HBCU. In my own way, I do encourage them to get some of the same training that I have gotten. I'm so glad that I have attended Savannah State University and HBCU.
Greetings. I am Dr. Zadonna Slay, and I love the HBCU experience. So what made me decide to attend an HBCU? At an early age, it was the images of the college experience from Jet, Ebony, and Essence magazines, as well as growing up watching A Different World in the early 90s. I wanted my own Hillman College experience. I took for granted having an HBCU in my hometown of Savannah, Georgia, and sought opportunities elsewhere to later learn that Savannah State would become my HBCU. In terms of qualities that I developed from attending an HBCU, I learned about respectability, not making the popular decision, but the right one. Resourcefulness, thinking out of the box, finding a way, making a way, and being creative just to make things happen. Confidence, I don't doubt or second guess myself. It's the grooming that I received from professors, faculty, staff, administration at my HBCU that taught me not only to achieve higher heights in academic material, but also to perfect those soft skills of making eye contact, being ethical, making sound decisions, having a work ethic, finding balance, being a critical thinker, and dispelling those myths and stereotypes that are out there. I also gained the quality of being competitive. Competitive in the sense that my education at Savannah State is bar none and is just as viable as any other institution, HBCU or non-HBCU. I would absolutely recommend attending an HBCU to others. If not possible as an undergraduate, definitely seek opportunities to attend an HBCU at a graduate level. While I'm biased that the undergraduate experience is a once in a lifetime experience because you're young, you're finding yourself, you're impressionable, you need that extra push, an HBCU can mold you and help you, define yourself in a way that other institutions are not able to. My HBCU experience impacted my life trajectory by giving me an awareness of culture, an appreciation of the history, pride, and contributions of Blacks in different disciplines and fields. I'll admit I was not a history lover. Over the years, I have become a student of history, wanting to learn more about the Afrocentric perspective as it relates to different fields and disciplines in a way that I didn't always realize. It was an African-American history course that really was the game changer for me. I learned to find the value in voice of Blacks, not to stray away or shy away from the voice and the contributions that Blacks have made in society. Through my HBCU, I have found mentors, colleagues, lifelong friends, and so much more. It's afforded me the opportunity to position myself in order to reach my career goals, succeed my career goals, and to be able to give back to my institution, not only financially, but also with my time and talents. It's important to give back to the HBCU that gives so much to you beyond the academic scope?
It's Brigadier General Kenneth Hubbard. I am a 1986 graduate of South Carolina State University, a historically Black college and university. I served 32 years in the United States Army, and I appreciate this opportunity to participate in Savannah State University's National Freedom Day 2022 commemoration. I received a list of questions to focus my remarks on this year's theme of the HBCU experience, a tale of liberation. I will try my best to address these topics, but it may be much easier for me to just tell my story. I was raised in a military family, living all over the world. My father served 30 years in the United States Army. I actually graduated from Bradwell Institute in Hinesville, Georgia, right down the road. But I am a proud representative of the HBCU legacy. My mother and father graduated from then South Carolina State College. My brother and sister graduated from South Carolina State University. I have many aunts, uncles, cousins. My nephew graduated from this esteemed university. My childhood was filled with South Carolina State University homecomings and family graduations. Now, you may think that I was forced to attend this university, but I actually made my final decision to attend South Carolina State because of the financial benefits. I received a 4-year Army ROTC scholarship, which was designated for the recipient to attend a historically Black college. I knew this was a blessing from God. You know, after living my childhood in Europe and around the United States in predominantly white military communities and schools, it was refreshing to attend an HBCU with my family and my friends. I felt like I was home. SCSU provided me the environment I needed to excel in my higher education goals. I have to admit, I also enjoyed the social aspect of an HBCU along with the fraternal involvement, Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated, which was truly enriching and rewarding experience. South Carolina State University also has the best ROTC program for minority officers and has produced more minority Army generals than any other university except for the United States Military Academy at West Point. My HBCU experience provided me a learning environment where I felt the teachers truly cared for me, had my best interests in heart, and wanted to see me succeed. Not just in school, but in life. Most of the lessons were taught through the lens of life after graduation. I was able to develop personal as well as leadership skills through military training and class projects. The HBCU experience also provided me the social skills required to have a good time while being able to focus on my primary purpose of obtaining my degree and receiving my commission as a lieutenant in the United States Army. I would highly recommend an HBCU to anyone who is looking for a great learning environment and fun college experience. I do not believe I would have achieved the rank of general in the United States Army if I did not attend a historically Black college like South Carolina State University. If I were to sum up the three aspects which I attribute to my HBCU experience, there would be first the caring educational environment, second, the leadership-oriented military training, and third, the social interaction skills. I hope my snapshot of my HBCU experience provides you with my view on how I was liberated and set my life trajectory on a path for success. This was Brigadier General Kenneth Hubbard, United States Army, and a proud alumni of a historically Black university.
The primary quality that I developed is pride in oneself. It was really an opportunity to gain self-confidence and to take much needed pride in what I could accomplish on my own. And attending an HBCU, I learned that about myself, and it's something that I did not learn from my undergraduate institution. So I think the HBCU experience impacted my trajectory by me just bringing a different mindset into the workplace when I started. I can think back to my first position after law school and the role that I played. You know, I was an attorney just like the other attorneys in the office, but I was able to see things from a different vantage point. And it wasn't simply about being Black. It was also about having that experience of working or being educated in an HBCU, having a caring disposition that I think comes from being with an HBCU. And I was able to take it to that position, and it continued throughout my life. And also, I think that helped my trajectory because I did work differently than the other attorneys. Our education generally was the same, but the experiences that I was able to bring to the table was quite differently, and that helped with my trajectory. You know, and that trajectory actually helped me get here to Savannah State University in my current position as president. Without that time at Texas Southern University's Thurgood Marshall School of Law, I don't know that whether I would have ended up working with an HBCU. And so I'm very grateful that I now am here at Savannah State and now able to make a difference on so many others' lives.
Welcome back. The next topic that we would like to unpack is, after all the wonderful things that we've identified that our HBCU experience has provided us with, what has that now moved us to want to give back? What has that inspired us to create, to then pour into others?
You know, I think most importantly, what I've been inspired to give back is just the interest to give back, because I really was not that present in myself at first. I was more worried about showing others what I was capable of. But I think in seeing what other people were capable of and what other different things they did to me, and maybe sometimes what they did better than me, at least in my own eyes, inspired me to be more flexible. And that's something I want to show to the people who, you know, are around me. I don't really consider anyone beneath me, even if I am in a position of leadership. Because, it's, you know, inspiration moves in a cycle. And I think in that same way that you introduced it, and actually in my own life personally, I think that's the exact way it's being distributed. I mean, I've been inspired to, most of all, just inspire others to, you know, find it in their heart, saying things that I didn't feel were very alive in me before coming to Savannah State, which is just giving what you have to give, or locating what you have to give within yourself, and finding ways, my way, through art and expression, to communicate that to the people who, you know, you're able to touch. And, one thing I definitely noticed is that going to a university, the amount of people you can touch is widespread. Like, it is definitely multiplied greatly. And, you know, they say, and a lot of professions, I feel like most professions, anyone you ask will say it's about who you know. But I know in mine, most of all, as a designer and as a film student and all these other things, it's about who you know. And who you know, it definitely, like I said, it multiplies. And if that doesn't inspire me, and if that doesn't inspire others, to inspire more people, just having connections to more people and people who do all kinds of different things, like I was saying before, whether it's art, what they do in their time in the university as a scholar, and what they do in their personal life when it comes to community service and things. Because not everybody has like an organization that gives them the platform to give back. But there are plenty of people out here, despite what people will have you think in the media, that are pure enough to give back. I mean, there's a lot of beautiful souls out here, especially in an area like this. So I'm not quite sure where that point was going, but I think that's where I need to go. Yeah, it's all pretty intertwined. It's really, I guess, where you know that loss and the train of thought really brings it back. Everything is really connected. Yeah. It's just funny how it happened that way.
It happens in cycles.
And now we're back in the beginning. So, why don't we cycle around through what has been talking
about? Let's go to this side.
Well, I know for me, you know, pretty much just like Ramsey said, it just inspires me just to give back. Like in the video when the gentleman was saying like how most universities hold a question mark above their heads, but at HBCU they hold a crown over their head to inspire you to rise. Mm-hmm. That's what I would like to do for, you know, individuals here on this university as well as out in the community. I would like to try to be like a mentor to everybody as well as, you know, just giving back. Like with my testimony about scholarships, just give, you know, scholarships of my own to everybody, you know, that's, you know, deserving and needing. You know, because, you know, similar situations, you know, everything I believe like happens over and over in life. You know, not every situation is a nuance. Everything, you know, repeats itself probably in different circumstances, but it's, you know, different, same stuff. But I just, like I said, want to just be a mentor to all the young gentlemen as well as, you know, young women in the future and scholarship. Just, you know, just want to be a pillar for the community as well as, you know, university and just, know that I'm here for the future and just always want to support.
I can definitely say I agree with all of these things, especially what Remy said about it's not really what you know, it's who you know. But to go deeper in that, there's a man here, you know, Shad Dawson. He taught me that it's definitely who you know, but it's how they know you. Mm-hmm. Because if you definitely have an impact on someone, you definitely truly be yourself and, you know, give yourself to the community and to people, you know, people really understand you and who you are as a person. They're definitely going to help you get to the doors and help you access things that you really need. And, you know, definitely having that kind of connection, especially, you know, going out into the community is definitely beneficial because you can always go out there, benefit other people in better ways and show them that, you know, you can always have a helping hand no matter where it is. Like, definitely how they know you and how you present yourself will really, you know, the first impression is always key. So always give a lead with a good impression, and you'll always, you know, have a door there to be open for you.
So I definitely want to give back in two major ways. One, I want to give back by actually creating a non-traditional student scholarship. There's so many people out there, I want to look them in the face and say, go back to school, sis. Go back to school, bro, you got this. Or go, if you've lived a little bit and your passion has changed or God has told you, well, your first degree you went for money, now go back for your passion, which is what happened with me. And sometimes they say, well, you know, I have family, I have children, I can't quit my day job and take classes that may be a 10 a.m. required class, so I can't do that. I want to create a scholarship that they need to take, you know, some time off of work to go and get this degree, that they can do that. And then the second way I want to give back is creating jobs for my classmates. Mm-hmm. I run into so many brilliant people that know exactly what they want to do and what field they want to be in. And like our founder, Richard Wright, he did all the things. He was not afraid to create multiple new jobs. And he was a major, he was a banker, he was a principal, he founded Augusta Sentinel. He did all the things. And in that way, I have a lot of ideas in different lanes. And I want to be able to make all of those ideas into businesses and then come right back to Savannah State and say, I want to hire this classmate, I want to hire that classmate. And then stuff that while students are in school, because sometimes students in school still need a job, but it's so hard to find a job that will work with your school schedule. So I wanted to be able to work for one of my companies and like, okay, you have class at this time or this time, okay, go to class and come back. It's so hard. And so I just want to be able to make it easier for the next round of students to be able to do what they need to do what they their passion is, and not have to suffer.
For sure. I would definitely plan to give back. So much has been poured to me, so I think it's only right that we do give back. As I said earlier, a man that didn't even go to Savannah State decided to pour into me, and he even said to me that this is just your testimony to be able to give to someone else. So for sure, definitely scholarship for students who may be facing adversities, or if you are not, which is to, as you said, make it easier for us to be able to do the things that we do. Also for myself, as I touched on earlier, the sense of self that Savannah State provided me, I definitely plan to teach. I definitely plan to teach Black Studies as I am. I do major in Africana Studies. If I would have known what I know now back then, who knows who I could have been or what I could have been doing if I would have had that sense of self that I did not have, but I do have now. So definitely pouring into young students, young Black students, or just young students in general, to let them know that you are amazing, and because you come from greatness, you are going to be great as long as you claim that. So for sure, pouring into young minds and letting them know that you have the space to be who you want to be unapologetically, for sure.
On the left side, and then we come in.
I'll kind of add, because you just mentioned Richard R. Wright. Also remember Melvin Boston and how he was, you know, trying to collect all the funds for scholarships, and, you know, it all happened to him. You know, just try to, you know, remember that piece.
Beautiful, beautiful addition.
Beautifully tackled, the way that you all tackled that subject was beautiful, right? And with all of the things that the university has given all of us, I would like to just touch on some of the things that it's given me directly, right? And from a community service perspective, they taught me how to give back. They taught me how it feels to give back, and they taught me how easy it is to give back. One of the things that stops us as a people is convenience, unfortunately, right? It stops us from moving as a world, you know, as a society as a whole, because things are inconvenient. And how many times do we circumvent something just because it's not convenient? Like all of us had talked about in the beginning topic, some of the universities we didn't go to because you have to pay for application fees. It's a convenience thing. A free application is convenient. So then I apply. So then I go. Scholarships. You go to a university that may not be where your heart lies, although you did the opposite. You do that because it's convenient. Oh, I don't have to pay anything. I go. So when community service is hard, it keeps the masses from getting involved. So the fact that they gave us a platform to make us make it evident how easy it was, and to guide us through how easy it is, and not only that, but helping us identify what we have to give back that we may not have thought was something that we could give to people. You know what I mean? Whether, like you said, your art, or even graphic designer for the event, that's giving back. Us coming here today to come and speak on this subject and create history, that's giving back. You know, the video, and then sharing that, even the individuals that carry the content that was created and spread it, they disseminate that information to other students and the youth, that's giving back. So just by taking and sharing a link, you're giving back, right? Just by going out here and promoting the university, you're giving back. Just by proving that something can be done, you're giving back. And those are all platforms for us to create community service-oriented organizations or nonprofit organizations. And understanding those concepts, the knowledge, the experience, the hardships, and everything that I have been equipped with through this HBCU experience, that's what I feel we have a duty to return to the community. So luckily, I've had the opportunity to again donate to a scholarship for an organization that I was once a leader in. Not only that, but I'm in a position, and I've worked there and very much so attained it due to my involvement in extracurriculars in addition to having my degree. I'm in a position now where I've been able to hire several students from Savannah State University that are STEM majors and promote them into full-time positions once they obtain their degrees. You know, I'm very intentional about it. When I see a gap that needs to be filled with my leadership power and capability at the company that I work with now, I make it my duty to inject my university into that streamline, right? I put them in there and I say, we're having issues hiring. So let's get in touch with Savannah State University. Let's get in touch with Armstrong. Oh, we're trying to fill certain gaps. We need talent. There's plenty of talented individuals that I mentor directly. And then I let individuals know that mentorship is a great way to combat a hiring crisis. Right? Because you know what these students are majoring in. You know what their situation is. To your point, right? It's about how they know you. I know you. I know you're majoring in computer science. I know that you don't know exactly what you want to do when you get out. I know that you may be struggling securing internships because, you know, school is a little bit hard for you with the distractions that we're faced with. So your GPA is not the best. But guess what else I know? I know your work ethic. I know what you're capable of. I know that this opportunity, if I give it to you, that you're gonna take it and you're gonna make our university look good. I know that you're gonna make me look good. I know that you're gonna make our people look good.
I know you.
I know you. You know what I mean? So those are some of the ways that I have been moved already to give back to the community and then some.
And we appreciate that. As an alum, we need that to let the world know that we are greatness and we come from greatness and you can get anywhere from here. So thank you for that, for realizing that after you leave, it doesn't mean that the greatness stops. It just continues to magnify. And so to put us in those places and to show the world that, you know, Savannah State is that spot. We are that spot. We really completely appreciate that as alum and just as an individual altogether. So thank you for that.
I appreciate that. Energy is something that, you know, they said can't be created or destroyed, right? So I like to be the conduit that transfers that energy from those wealths of knowledge to the other individuals. So I'm the bridge. I'm the conduit that energy travels through and helps those individuals grow and understand where it is that they truly come from. And that's another benefit of the history that we have here and learning it from other Black people. Talk to me.
I just want to challenge even current students that if you're in a position of influence now, don't wait until you graduate to open doors or connect or network with your classmates. Being that I am a non-traditional student, y'all gotta keep hearing me say that because I'm a champion for non-traditional students. I already had things that I was doing professionally before I came back to school. So I already had a production company that I was doing independent projects with. I have one coming up. And all the PAs, the dancers, the actors I hired, I booked classmates, like I'm paying them. And if you're in a position to do that, don't wait until after school, because you already see them, you look at them every day, you know. So network, you know, what is it called, lateral or horizontally? Networking.
It's all the same thing. It's all in a line.
Network with the people around you, you know. You don't have to wait till you get out of school and start doing stuff like that.
It's all the same, right? With that being said, we'll take this opportunity to share some additional reflections from other HBCUs.
Hello, my name is Dr. Tina Smith, and I am chair of the Department of Speech Pathology and Audiology at Tennessee State University. I decided to attend an HBCU because my parents attended an HBCU. And so I have legacy, but also because of the outstanding mentorship that I knew I would receive from faculty and support personnel and others at an HBCU. At the time that I attended college, I was just so thrilled to be there. It was exciting for me because, again, not only the mentorship, but I was excited to be a part of the culture of an HBCU.
My name is Zaire Langdon. I am a senior at Lincoln University, the first HBCU. Today I will be talking about my experience at Lincoln and just answering a couple questions. So what is the reason why I attended HBCU? So Lincoln University is in Pennsylvania. I'm from Pennsylvania, 45 minutes away from Lincoln, Philadelphia. That's where I'm from. That is one of the main reasons. Also, I have family member that attended Lincoln University and graduated from Lincoln University. So that is part of the main reason why I attended Lincoln University.
Hi, my name is Michelle Brown Rawl, and I'm a proud graduate of an HBCU, Tuskegee University. I am a vice president at an Atlanta-based engineering firm, and I'm very proud to say that I attended an HBCU. What made me attend on an HBCU was not the what, but maybe the who. My parents graduated from Tuskegee Institute. They took me to visit the campus as a child and introduced me to the best homecoming activities that I ever seen. Basically, they were brainwashing me, or should I say, indoctrinating me into the experience, Tuskegee Pride. I applied to other colleges, but only wanted to attend Tuskegee because it had my intended major, and I knew I'd be surrounded by other people that looked like me.
So, hey guys, this is Olaremi Sano, graduate of Grambling State University, the Grambling State University, Gram Fam, and I'm definitely happy to be a part of this experience talking about HBCUs and liberation and what that means to us as a people. I'm a graduate of Grambling State University. I was there from 86 to 90, participated as a D1 scholarship athlete, women's volleyball, the very first volleyball team at Grambling, And I had an amazing experience my 4 years at Grambling. I'm very happy to talk about it. We were asked to talk about why we chose our HBCU, and I chose my HBCU honestly because of the band. In seventh or eighth grade here in Dallas, Texas, we were able to see Grambling State University's band perform at one of the, you know, I think it might have been one of the professional football games at halftime. And so the band was so funky and fly, you know, had so much life and rhythm that I actually was like, okay, I'm going to that school.
I am Dr. Marsha Allen Owens, and I am currently serving at one HBCU, Florida A&M University, where I am Associate Professor of Environmental Science and Policy and Director of the Center for Faculty Advancement. I attended an HBCU. Why the choice? Well, I'm of an age where we didn't have as many choices. My parents both attended what was then called Jackson College for Negro Teachers in the 1950s. My mother graduated from there in 1954. By the time my father graduated in 1956, it was Jackson State College. And by the time my brother and I graduated, it was then Jackson State University. So I come from a family that has taken HBCUs as an opportunity for education and uplift and freedom. So as the fourth of four, although I had choices, I had other choices, I chose Jackson State University because it was what I knew, it was home, it was familiar, and I have never regretted that choice.
My name is Kirsten Pratt, and I am a proud 2011 graduate of South Carolina State University. Go Bulldogs! And I'm the current Associate Vice President of Apprenticeship Carolina, based out of Columbia, South Carolina. I always knew that I was going to attend a historically Black college and university, or an HBCU, because my family both worked and attended an HBCU, and I was afforded the opportunity to actually grow up on Savannah State University's campus. It was always a very exciting atmosphere, very family-oriented, and I loved that it was a culture of Black intellectuals. So for me, that was very important when it was time for me to decide to attend college.
I decided to go to an HBCU because I attended predominantly white schools all my life. In fact, my graduating class, 40 out of 432 students were Black.
Greetings and Happy New Year. My name is Dr. Iris Cooper. I'm known as Dr. I here in Columbus, Ohio. I'm originally from Evansville, Indiana. And I went to Bossy High School in the 70s and graduated in 1971. However, getting into college at that time was more than just filling out applications. There was definitely a slant toward white students at the time. And when it was time for me to apply to schools, my parents had to come to school with me, because the counselor didn't believe that I was the kind of student to be able to go to an Ivy League college or a highly ranked, even Black school. He said I should consider being a, let's say a clerical worker, or someone that worked in the government. And my parents said, no, she's going to college and you are going to sign these applications. So after some tense moments, he signed them and he sent them off. And I went to Fisk in the fall of 71, fell in love with Fisk University, had a ball, but at the same time, I had to keep my grades up.
It's always hurdles when you go to an HBCU, but it's always hurdles in life, because in life, you always get thrown some curveballs and you try to understand what life is all about. But going to a historically Black college, it was implemented in me that, you know what, I can be successful going to a smaller school but also being around a lot of people of color. And that just made it even more because they were just as smart as it going to any other school that is around. You know, you didn't have to go to the Dukes or the North Carolinas or the University of Virginia, but Hampton was stood alone by itself.
In terms of my experiences at HBCUs, at Jackson State, I was taught leadership. I was taught self-regard, self-respect. I left Jackson State with skills that still take me through life. There were certain isms that we didn't have to deal with on a daily basis. You didn't have to go a full day not seeing someone who looked like you. Through the Sonic Boom of the South, our marching band, I became a leader. Through my sorority, Delta Sigma Theta, I became a leader. Through other student organizations, my leadership skills were developed and cultivated in a supported environment with lots of love and affirmation.
Some of the hurdles that I experienced because of my involvement at an HBCU was a negative stereotype that my choice was for an HBCU was my only choice, and that my education would be subpar to what I would receive from majority institutions. I overcame this hurdle through my hard work and perseverance. We often tease that it may be easy to get in, but it's hard to get out. Basically, Tuskegee is a university that will meet you where you're at, but won't let you graduate until you have all the knowledge and skills that you need to succeed, not just at a job, but in life.
Now, I'll start with my faculty by saying from the beginning of the advisement period, when I decided that I wanted to be a speech language pathologist, the faculty were very integral in my education and guiding me in the right direction to make sure that I could achieve my goals. And so that was very important to me. They showed that they cared about my success. And as a result of that, they not only guided me through the academic component of the program, but they also guided me into the profession in itself. They encouraged me to go on and get a master's, and they helped me get through the steps to be able to do that, and then to pursue the doctoral degree.
I would say that HBCU really has shaped who I am today. Because of all of the travel opportunities, the leadership opportunities, and the ability to interact and grow my network of both talented and intelligent Black persons, for me, I am in the line of business that I am in today, creating work opportunities in economic development for the citizens of South Carolina, because when during my time at State, I was afforded several opportunities, both internships, jobs, and learning experiences that really shaped who I am today and put me on the path trajectory that I am right now.
The qualities I developed from my experience attending an HBCU are pride, perseverance, and purpose. Pride came from knowing the history of the many greats and other success stories from graduates of Tuskegee, like renowned scientist George Washington Carver, the Tuskegee Airmen, and even my parents. Perseverance, as I mentioned before, came from being required to stand side by side with the majority and be able to hold my ground and prove that I was capable of excellence. Purpose came from understanding that not only my career path was important to share with others coming up behind me, but my purpose was also to share the experience of an HBCU that cannot be gained anywhere else. I would absolutely recommend attending an HBCU to others. The experience is a personal one. While you're still surrounded by some of the best and brightest from all over the world, there's nothing like it. My HBCU experience impacted my life trajectory in so many ways. And every step that I took in developing my career, knowledge of my Tuskegee background was seen as a plus because of the reputation and pride that people know. People also were able to help in my networking, being able to connect with people from all over the country to be able to help support my endeavors and my career path, as well as personally.
Because of my experience there, I had the opportunity to have a leadership role at another HBCU, Kentucky State University. These HBCU experiences made me want to give back to others, and I've done that throughout my career with different professional and Greek letter organizations. I'm Michelle Brown Rawl, and I love the HBCU experience.
We went to Grambling, my sister and I, but we went for very different reasons because we learned about the educational experience, the richness of culture in HBCUs. We had an amazing time the 4 years that we were there. And I, like I said, played on the women's volleyball team. So we were asked some questions to talk about our experience. You know, HBCUs are wonderful in regard to culture. People actually live and learn together. The professors are very, 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 very warm and family-like. And I don't think there's anything like it. You cannot explain what it means to go to an HBCU. People would have to literally live that experience. So it is a lived experience. And for me, my professors, I was an English major. And so my professors, we had smaller classes because people don't rush to join English as an academic choice. So we had small classes. We loved each other. Our teachers, you know, gave us hard work. They were not easy on us. Grambling, like other HBCUs, can tend to be a party school, but you have to learn how to balance that out. And really what I recommend about HBCUs is going there for the family experience, the family feel, the cultural feel, you know, the band, you know, the academics. We have amazing people that graduate from HBCUs all over the country. We have an amazing impact that we make on this society in the United States. And we have amazing leaders. We have amazing talented entertainers. We have amazingly talented football players and basketball players, you know, people in sports of all kind. But what we have for the most part is a continuation of culture. And that's very important in terms of HBCUs and liberation. So there are some obstacles. Sometimes, you know, the systems might not be as updated as other schools. Sometimes, you know, we probably need to take it up a little bit in regard to investment, in regard to creating endowments across the HBCUs. All 107 of them need bigger and better endowments. I think we can do a better job at that. But if we are being what we need to be in terms of self-assessment, then we wouldn't have a problem with pointing that out and working on it. So my name is Olaremi Sano. I graduated from Grambling in May of 1990. And I was amazingly happy to be a part of that experience. I wouldn't give it for the world. I go back every single year as at homecoming. And, you know, hopefully this will be some inspiration for some of the people that are coming behind us. My son is now attending Florida A&M University. We have a completely HBCU family. My sister and I went to Grambling. My dad was the head football coach at Florida A&M. And my brother graduated from Florida A&M. My dad's wife graduated from Florida A&M. So we have a FAMU Grambling family. But guess what? The G is what wins every time. Y'all have a good day.
The unique thing that only an HBCU can provide is it creates an environment that removes this a subconscious stress and misunderstandings that comes with being a minority. As a Black American woman, being in an academic environment of Black intellectuals and where Blacks were the majority really created a space for me to learn and understand my culture and myself that's really helped me develop who I am today. College was the best time of my life, and I will always support HBCUs.
So qualities I feel like I have developed while attending HBCU, first and foremost would be leadership. Growing up, I have always been involved in different organizations, clubs, sports, stuff like that. But actually coming here pushed me to want to do more. And I'm currently serving as the president of Eloquent Commitment to Helping Our Sisters. I serve as the vice president of the Gamma Upsilon chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated. I've held a lot of e-board positions throughout my organizations. I'm also a peer mentor. So leadership would definitely be the number one quality I developed. And just also being more sociable. Being at HBCU, it's hard to stay in your room and just not do anything. Everybody I know, all my friends, they are all doing something, all active in something. So socialness as well.
My undergraduate experiences still give me great memories. There's nothing like going to your own homecoming. There's nothing like an HBCU homecoming. And often those experiences, those extracurricular experiences, seem to be the things that define us. And so, yes, our cultures are rich, our bands are great, our athletic programs are great, but first, we're a university and we're all there learning. We're all there learning with people who actually care about us. And so now I am a professor at yet another HBCU, Florida Agricultural and Mechanical University, FAMU, where I am imparting the same kind of wisdom and care. Excellence with caring is the motto at FAMU. And I hope that I am imparting the same kind of wisdom and care and modeling that excellence with caring that has become part of the rich history and legacy of an HBCU. And so my life trajectory would not have been the same if I had made some of the other choices in the late 1970s. I would have been one of the first to integrate some of the schools that I was offered admission to. But at the age of 16, graduating from high school, I made a 16-year-old's choice. And that was to go with the school that had raised me. I literally grew up on the campus of Jackson State as my mother was faculty there. There were some challenges going to school where your mother was an administrator, but I do not regret the choice. I do not regret the choice of teaching at an HBCU. I'm paying it forward and I'm honoring those who invested so much into me. And so now with our HBCUs now being researched to institutions on the Carnegie scale, that means that we are engaged in high levels of research. And so now at Florida A&M University, I am producing PhDs at HBCUs. My mother did not have the opportunity to get a PhD from an HBCU. And so now our HBCUs are producing research degrees, and our students stand up against any other institution because that same level of excellence with caring, that same level of high expectation is still there because there are still people who hold those biases that we are less than. But your HBCU degree is not an albatross around your neck, but you leave knowing who you are. You leave confident in what you are able to do, and you have great memories and great history and great heritage standing behind you.
And that's what really impressed me about the hurdles that I had to go through, especially preparing me for life. That's what Hampton was, education for life. The qualities that I inherited from HBCU was that I knew how to prepare for life. Life is going to be a struggle, but yet it's also understanding how do you achieve your goals in that struggle. My job as a student in a historically Black college is to represent my family, and family's very important to me. So as I walked and embarked in life, every time I walked on the court or walked around, I represent not only myself, but I represent my family and the history of African Americans coming over to achieve an education. Hell yeah, I would recommend going to a historically Black college, because one thing, if you're pursuing a quality education, it's very important that you go to a place where you feel that you have less people in the class where you can learn more. Not being at a big school, nothing wrong with going to a big school, but having that person, the people who care for you day in and day out. It was just great for me, and the integrity that I received from my teachers was very important. Well, let's see, the experience that I received is that going to a historically Black college, especially getting into the MBA, it was rough because people kept saying, well, you go to a small school. I looked at people like Earl Lloyd, Earl of Pearl Monroe, Sam Jones, guys who, Willis Reed, guys who really helped paved the way for me to get into the NBA. Had the pleasure of playing with a Bobby Dandridge from Norfolk State University, and also a Carlos Terry from Winston-Salem State that was one of my teammates with the Washington basketball club that I played for. So that prepared me for life, because now I had to work even harder, not going to the Dukes or the Virginias or the North Carolinas. I had to work even harder.
So my decision to attend an HBCU centered around mentorship that I knew I would receive. And there were no hurdles from my experience because I was involved at an HBCU. The preparation that I received was outstanding, both at the undergraduate level and at the graduate level. I learned about leadership. I learned about integrity. I participated in community service. And I just had just such support to help me pursue the goals that I was trying to obtain. And so the qualities that I developed from my experience attending HBCU are things like perseverance and humility and service and just giving back, because that's what I got from my experience at an HBCU. So I would recommend anyone attending an HBCU. In fact, my sons both attended an HBCU. I wanted them to go to an HBCU before they went to a majority school so that they could experience the culture, and also so that they would have the mentorship that they needed to be successful. And so the HBCU experience had a great impact on my life trajectory. As a result of attending an HBCU, I learned something about being a leader, and also, again, about giving back. So once I graduated with a doctoral degree, I came back to South Carolina State University to give back. I also have been at Tennessee State for 20 years, and I promote a family atmosphere and caring about my students. And I need my students, well, competitive, to be competitive, but also to know something about helping each other. If we're going to be successful, we need support. And you can get that support at an HBCU. So it was an honor and a pleasure to attend an HBCU, and I would recommend to everyone to have that experience. With that being said, I'd like to thank you for listening to me.
Would I recommend attending an HBCU to other students or just people in general? Yes, I would recommend attending an HBCU to, you know, anybody. It's a lot of history behind HBCUs, a lot of different cultures, people from all over that come together. And I just feel as though it's just a different experience. It's a lot of culture, tradition, history, and each HBCU, they have their own unique thing that they have. But, you know, as a collective, we're all one big family.
Now, one of the qualities that I developed from being an HBCU student was perseverance, because not everything isn't perfect at HBCUs. In most cases, HBCUs are underfunded. They don't have the nicest things. They don't have the latest technology, but you still make do with what you have, and you persevere no matter what. And that's one of the biggest things that I've taken from my HBCU experience. Would I recommend it to students? Absolutely. All the time I recommend that students try and attend an HBCU. It is an experience like none other. And I understand that our world is not predominantly Black, but for many of us, just having those 3, 4, 5 years in that world is something that can truly change your life. Now, for me, being at an HBCU, it totally changed the trajectory of my life. I didn't even think I was going to go to college. I didn't think I was a college student. Being in such a caring environment, it really nurtured a part of me that I didn't know was there. You see, I went to predominantly white schools, and a lot of times I was the only Black student in my class. I remember telling one of my white teachers that I was going to college, and he laughed in my face. So you can imagine what it felt like for me to be at an HBCU where most of the people look like me, and even those that didn't, they cared so much about me. I can remember the day that I stepped on Cheney University of Pennsylvania's campus. I felt the love and I fell in love. I owe Cheney my life. I wouldn't have the success that I have if it wasn't for Cheney. And that's the reason why I go hard for my alma mater. I volunteer to my alma mater. I give money to my alma mater. And Cheney is a beneficiary in my estate plan. I'm Bernadette L. Harris, and I love my HBCU experience.
There were some sharp, sharp Black people teaching and attending Fisk University that I had never been around before. So my ego was a little deflated, really, but I was just glad to be in the room with such smart, sharp people. And not only that, to learn about who I was really. Like, I had heard my parents talk about their parents and grandparents in the South and how they weren't able to finish school and had to work on the farms, and many of them escaped to come to the North for a better life. That's what my parents did. And they were determined that my brother and I would have the best education ever. So when Fisk lost money when I was there after my sophomore year, I had to come home to Indiana University to finish, but never ever forgot the relationships, like with Sister Carolyn there. We used to have a ball in Jubilee Hall, just had a ball. Sometimes never went to bed, but we got our homework done, and you have to do that too. So the HBCU experience really tells you about your history and what you're capable of, because you won't hear that in a white school. Now with this critical race theory, our children won't hear it. So pay attention to what you're learning at an HBCU, because you may not hear it if you go to a white school. Nevertheless, I finished with a journalism degree at Indiana, only Black student in many classes there, and then went back and got an MBA through the Consortium for Graduate Study and Management for Minorities at Indiana. My career has been fruitful. I've worked in many, many different industries. I even went back and got my doctorate about 8 years ago. I'm known as the founder of Glory Foods, if you've ever seen it in the grocery store. I was the only woman on the team to come up with that concept. I've worked in government. I've had my own business several times. I've worked in banking. I've worked in community development. I believe that I can do just about anything I put my mind to it because of the self-esteem that I gain going to an HBCU. So take advantage of this time. You will never see it again, because this world and this nation is completely toxic right now on integration and giving everybody a chance. So get the best education you can, develop those relationships with the faculty as well as the students, because you're going to need them after you leave the school. And I just pray that the environment that you go into after you graduate will be much more welcoming than it is right now. So stay focused, stay healthy, pay attention, read the newspaper, read anything you can find about what's going on with the world today, and stay close to those people that you meet on campus. Those relationships are worth more than gold. And I wish you well. I hope that you stay safe. And remember, you are a star, so shine.
I absolutely and wholeheartedly recommend that students attend an HBCU. The experiences that one can have while attending an HBCU are just dynamic, from having faculty members, staff members who are willing to work with our students wherever they are and make sure that they are able to advance in their studies, advance in their experiences, and engage in various activities. Our faculty, our staff, just like those of all of the HBCUs, care about the students. That caring nature is what sets us apart from other institutions, and that caring nature is what advantages our students from others. And so we are very grateful to welcome students regardless as to race, color, creed, national origin, but to give them the cultural experience that will be life-changing.
As we continue in this fruitful conversation, I think it is noteworthy as we're talking about this HBCU experience and tale of liberation and Richard Wright's impactfulness in commemorating National Freedom Day. Freedom for him was a real, tangible subject. If you think about the first 12 years of his life, he was an enslaved African. But as a result of that, after taking that walk from Cutworth, Georgia, all the way to Atlanta, because his mother had the foresight to know that education really does mean freedom. And we all know the quote in the boxcar where he told General Howard, "Sir, tell them we're rising." And we think about the fact that 1890, he had the political acumen to gather people in the community to get the land grant, the Morrell land grant, and then launch where we are sitting here today. I just think that he really embodies the whole idea of peaks and valleys, being in the struggle, facing adversity, but yet on the other side of that, college president, leave here after 30 years, launch a bank, Citizens and Southern Bank, have a business with export business and coffee to Haiti. And so, you know, what does it mean to face adversity and come out on the other side? Maybe some of you can remember a time when you had to face adversity yourself, but yet you sit on this stage tonight and say, "I have continued to rise." If anybody who could share that.
So that was wonderfully introduced. I'll go ahead and share an experience that has never left me. It's been imprinted in my memory and everything that I do, and also injected into my purpose as well. And around 2016, whilst in the pursuit of my degree, I was about a sophomore in college at Savannah State, and it was around midterm time. I was working my jobs, right? You know, working my jobs because my parents are not just sending me bread. You know, I still got stuff I want to do. You got things you want to buy. You got to keep up maintenance on your car or save to get one if you don't have it. And just have some cash in case you get a balance this stuff, right? And in the midst of overworking myself and kind of deviating from my purpose because of how much of my time was being tied up in those things, I ended up having a near-death experience, a life-threatening accident at work that put me in the hospital. I was comatose for 5 days. I had a level 4 liver laceration, a kidney laceration, a punctured right lung, digestive system failure. I couldn't walk. I lost 28 pounds. I was intubated, so I was on life support for a little while, and I had to get an emergency blood transfusion and several emergency surgeries, all whilst also discovering in the midst of that I didn't have any health insurance through my parents any longer because of some political happenings between the two of them. All whilst taking on a full course load because I was in school, right? Midterms was coming up. I'm trying to take my test. So it was so tragic because it started as a regular day. You know, as most situations do that are ridiculous, right? They catch you just complete left field. I woke up at the same time every morning, went to class, did what I had to do, went to work, and didn't go back to the dorm after that, you know? And it was such a traumatic, emotional experience. I went through depression. I wasn't able to speak for a little while. And I'm the wordsmith. As you can see here, that's what I'm doing. I'm speaking,
You know, that's part of how I deliver my purpose to the world. So not being able to speak made me feel as though I never would again. Not being able to walk made me feel as though I never would again. Not being able to do things for myself, bathe myself, use the restroom myself, made me feel like I would never be able to do it again. Because it was something that was uncharted territory. But I had to see it through, right? And I remember when I was getting discharged from the hospital, you know, I was still in pretty bad shape. I'm like, yo, you know, y'all are discharging me already. I think I still need to be seen. I'm not ready to go yet. And they're like, hey, it's very expensive to stay here. So it's in your best interest with you not having any insurance to go and go wherever you're going to go. You know, already after accumulating $170,000 in hospital expenditures with no health insurance, right? So ridiculous. But I remember when I was getting discharged, my parents like, where do you want to go? I'm like, I'm not coming back home. I could barely walk, anything like that. But I'm like, what am I going to do? Come and sleep on the couch? Because I already didn't have a room anymore at the house since I left for college. So they downsized. So what am I going to do? Come and sleep on my dad's couch and be depressed? You know, be sad, be salty, I can't do nothing. I'm like, I need to go back. And the second that I'm able to get up and go somewhere, I need to go back to my classes. I have to graduate. I have a goal in mind. Beginning with the end in mind, keeping it in focus what your end goal is, right? And I continue to move with that. And I forced myself to get better. You know, I did some things that probably weren't safe, right? I was out there trying to do push-ups as soon as I could roll out of the bed because I was like, I got to get better. I'm looking at myself like, what happened to me? I was withering away. And I remember I could stand and I limped back to my classes and went to one of my classes. One of my professors said, what are you doing here? You missed 6 weeks of class. You think you can just walk back in here like everything's cool? I'm like, hey, man, listen, I was in the hospital. You know, man, I had to navigate that adversity as well because they didn't know what happened. Nobody told them, right? Only the people that knew who I was knew what took place. And because of the understanding and some of the other positive benefits of attending an HBCU that we've already addressed earlier, I was given the opportunity to take incompletes in the courses that I was taking from the midterm and be able to continue those in the following semester whilst also being able to take my next full credit, my full course load, so that I could still be on track for graduation on time. And I was able to do that because of how people knew me. They knew that I could do it. Because in many cases, you know, you would be set up for failure and being given an opportunity like that. So that is my adversity, or my most adverse situation that I faced, not only in my HBCU experience, but in my life. And my HBCU community are the individuals that uplifted me and continue to fill me with prayer and the energy to continue to overcome and persevere that.
I can definitely share my adverse story. I would say it's definitely nowhere near, but it's definitely something that we all had to get through, you know, just at being, you know, us in the situation that we are. I'll never forget my first semester sophomore year. It was 2018 fall, and unfortunately, the start of the semester was going strong. I'm the first, or not the first, but I'm the only male soul at this time. So, you know, I'm really starting to build, you know, bonds with certain people, you know, doing things outside of my comfort zone that I never really done before. And it was like a new life to me that I never really expected, because my freshman year I was not involved, stayed in my room and everything like that. So kind of being involved and stuff like that, having to have a positive mindset all the time, kind of to be, you know, always there and present, to be happy and, you know, joyful to people, show people that you can really get through things, you know what I'm saying, and not really show when you're down or anything like that, was kind of like different to me. But unfortunately, like 2 months into the semester, my grandmother passed, and that was someone who was my backbone. She raised me from when I was in diapers to, you know, seeing me as a grown man. And you know, it kind of traumatized me because I saw her the week before, and I was like, you know, I told her I'm coming back to see you. I haven't seen her in 2 years, being in school and stuff like that. So I knew she was very proud of me and stuff like that. And then getting that phone call kind of like really destroyed me. And going back home, dealing with the family, you know, it's in a crisis. You know, we lost one of our big backbones. You know, we never really had such a big impact or a big loss in our family like that. So it really impacted me physically, mentally, emotionally, everything like that. So coming back to Savannah State that semester, really, you know, I had no drive. I had no motivation. I was just like, I lost my world. And it's like, what can I do to get myself back to the point where I can have a smile on my face? I don't have to worry about anything. You know, I don't have to, you know I can make my grandmother happy knowing that I'm doing what she knew I could do. And having to go through that, you know, I definitely lost myself that semester. I had D's and F's. I've never seen, you know, that many D's and F's in my life, especially in one semester. I was just like, man, like, you know, like, whoever, like, why am I not focused? Like, what's going on? What's throwing me off track? And I had to realize that I had to find help within people. Because I was always I can do this by myself, you know, I don't really need anybody, you know. My grandma did everything for herself. I know that I can do it myself and not have no consequences, but those consequences reap the actions because I was the one taking all the fault for everything. I was like, it's my fault, you know. I should have been there for her. Like, if I was there, nothing would have happened. Like, just blaming myself for things that I really could not control. So having to go through that definitely was something big for me, and it was like, it definitely made me to the man I am today, because without that challenge of losing someone that was just the backbone for our entire family, really was like, okay, now you have to be either a new backbone or help being another stepping stool in the family to help, you know, the rest of the family.
That community saved us, man.
Definitely.
Community definitely saved me my last year of school. The level of depression I was in was scary. It was very, very scary. And having to deal with back home, them getting hit with a Category 5 hurricane, not having no idea what state my family was in, coming back to school, having to raise funds for that hurricane with my organization, the International Student Organization, losing my grandmother the same day we were losing funds, raising funds for that. And I've lost about 20 family members since then, just back to back to back. I'm so thankful for the family that I have at Savannah State, because I would not have graduated. My professor literally had to take me with her every day for about 3 weeks just to make sure I got out, I got air, I ate, so that I could be able to get back into what was normal life. During this time, I'm still serving in several organizations, still being a community assistant, making sure my residents were put first and taken care of. And after that, of course, the wonderfulness that is the pandemic and COVID hit. And then I lost the matriarch of my family, which was my great-grandmother. A week after I went home. And of course, I couldn't go back home because everything was shut down. So having to deal with that from a distance. Then Savannah State closed, and it's like, thank God for my boyfriend's family at the time, because I would have had nowhere to be. And I really have to be thankful for the family that I made here, because they made sure that they took care of me and made sure that I did not lose focus of the track of where I needed to go. They made sure that I was continually in a rising state, even when I myself wanted to give up and be defeated.
Thank God for sharing.
Yeah, thank God for that story, because it is clear that even though we are not biologically connected, we are all part of the root that has been planted here at Savannah State. And we are all part of that same strength that it took for our founder to even get to the point that he had. And so that legacy has been passed from person to person. And the people, we sit and stand on the shoulders of all of the students that have come before you, all of the faculty, all of the presidents, not just the first president. And it is a true testimony of liberation being here tonight.
And not only are we related through our experiences and our ability to relate to one another, but we are related by the history that this school is built on, right? And that's the beautiful thing about this. We deliver the good news first and the difficult news last. However, we're sitting here with you in the present day, and all of those things are in retrospect. However, they still hold value today. So with that being said, you all can see where we have gone from the places that we have been, where we have gotten
from the trolls to the peaks. And I think that that's phenomenal. And I'm very grateful to have had the opportunity to share the platform with all of the individuals here today. Something that I would like for everybody to contemplate and ponder on and hope that it can be thought-provoking and stimulate positive discussion is, do you feel liberated as a Black man and woman today as a result of both your experiences throughout your matriculation in university and as well as the opportunities that you've been able to obtain as a result of having your degree?
I just want to take this opportunity to say thank you for all of the rich submissions that we've received from all across the country, all of the HBCUs. Thank you, thank you, thank you.